What's up, everybody? Today I'm working on fixing bugs. Lots of bugs to be fixed today. Songbringer Day 461. So yeah, I got my old Trello list organized this morning. Now I'm just ripping through it, trying to get as many done as fast as I possibly can. So the first thing I'm gonna do is go to this first one here, the ice boss. There's a problem where the ice boss comes up and it goes grrr and appears. And if you hit her before she gets to the top, she'll keep on going forever. So she needs to be invincible first. Should be pretty simple to fix that. So I'm going to set the player to where that is and start debugging. Here we go. Save here. Let's just confirm this. Confirm debug pragmaticness. 1, 2, 3 engineering. That worked. I think I hit her with the sword. I know this is failed for me and many other people. This is a bug. I know this is a bug. Unless I fix something else to fix this indirectly. Let's try a sword or a bomb or maybe the top hat. Oh yeah, totally. See ya! Okay, I wonder why that worked that time. Just trying to isolate the problem here. So I hit her once. Okay, so maybe just the ghost sword doesn't work. Trying all these different attacks and stuff. I'm gonna try the debug attack. I wonder if that actually. I think this does. I hit her once with the debug attack. Oh. Maybe it's if she hits to a certain point. I love this boss. Really loving all these bosses, but yeah, okay, I guess it's just a sword. I don't know. Nothing else seems to be doing it. Alright, so anyways, let's grab the ice boss's AI and all that. To make her invincible at first, well, a pretty easy thing to do would be to change her category to be none or neutral or something other than foe. So that, or just her mask. Oh, that's the thing to do. Yeah. So she can't be hit by anything. This does make it confusing though, so if I ever go back up here, this is basically I'm coupling things here by setting this so that Basically, if I ever go back to this later, I'm like, oh, I want to change this. So she can't be hurt by the top hat. This is not going to work because this is. I'm changing her masks down here. What's up, Rocket Bunny? I guess I'll start with Mask None. Hopefully that makes it clear. And then when she stops here, mode 88, position Z, vector any, vector none, mask collision. Try that. How you doing today, Rocket Bunny? How's the finals going? Did I already, what did I do to make her invincible for when her shield's up? Oh, she has shield hit points. Ah, that's a better idea. Shield down, shield zero. Okay, shield hit points, much better idea. That way it's very clear. I can always go change her mask, and it's not going to affect this whole thing here. Okay, so starting off, she has this super shield. And then when she stops, she has no shield. And that way she can still be hurt. Pretty good. You finished it? Cool, Rocket Bunny. Nice, man. Done with finals. Done with finals. Woo! Let's see if I can trick the game, somehow break it again. And also make sure, yep, that's just a very simple change. So she's got a shield at first. How could I trick it? What could I do here to just make it break again? She could somehow be damaged or. Yes, this is fine. Yeah, I think this is okay. All right, cool. Bug fixed. I really don't think there's any way you could get around that other than hitting her with more than 999 damage, which is impossible. Cool. Good enough. One down. You're having trouble getting Coco set up in Visual Studio? What trouble? Okay, so I'm gonna go to this employee. What area was this? It was. This is right next to level 4, the entrance to level 4, and I think it was. Oh, halfway through the screen? This is maybe 1, 4, something like that. Why am I standing? It's better for my back. What's up, Saint? All right, so I'm gonna switch this to Mega Seed Employee. Go to that point, which was 1, 4, about 0. Let's go find this little spot. You download it, you got the source. Where do I compile it? You go to. Oh my God, I luckily got the exact right area. Let me see if I can show you, Rocket Bunny, where you go. There's a project file, and I think it's in the build folder. Just go to your build folder. Let me check that. Pretty sure I have a Cocos here. There's Cocos 3.9. I don't think they've changed it recently. Hopefully they haven't changed it. You probably have a much newer version than 3.9. You probably have 13.1, or I don't know if they have 14 yet. But let me show you where it was, and it's pretty simple, man. You just go to build, and then you just go Cocos 2D tests. Cocos 2D win32.solution. There you go, just open that, run it, that's it. It'll take a hell of a long time. But once it's all built, then you won't have to mess around with it too much. I think what's going on in this area is that there's water being added to this pattern. So if I go to where it adds water, and I just return no matter what, I think it will. You're welcome, man. This will confirm whether it was this add water function. Oh, it's not that. Oh. Really? How could it be adding that much water right there? What is this? This river just ends all of a sudden. What's adding water there? That's crazy. Is there add rivers or something like that? Oh, there is. There's add river, add lake. It might be one of these. It's probably add lake or add river. Let's try lake. Disable that one. Because it looked like a lake. It was like a corner thingy. Why would the maze style have lake here? Oh, it could be actually the sea. But no, it shouldn't be the sea. Hmm. Okay, it's not the river, or it's not the lake. Is it the river? Debugging day, fixing bugs. I got like 96 bugs on my list that are things I should get done soon. Trying to get maybe 20 of them done today. That's a lot. I might get more like 10 done today. That would be a good day. Not that either. What? No. Okay, well, let's try the add water again. What? If it's not that. I guess I'll look at the pattern. Or the gate. I mean, that would be really weird if it was the gate, though. I guess it could be the gate. See, that's like doing a whole quadrant, though. Oh, it could just be pattern quadrant. Could it? Man, I wish I had like twice the CPU power so I could stream and still code as fast as I normally do. Because this always slows down. The compiler's like, brrr. You want to stream and code? Brrr. Oh, it's not quadrants. What is causing this water down here? I guess the next thing is to check the pattern. The pattern is pattern top hat something. Think. Nope. Pattern gate four. Top hat switch, where the hell is that? Oh man, what is this? What the hell is this pattern? Top hat switch, tile top hat switch. No. Finding things in your own code. When you have like 72,000 lines of code. And then you've been writing a game for like 3 years. Sometimes you forget where things are. Like today. Mooring switch. There it is. Mooring switch. Patterns. What pattern is this? Mooring gate. What if this did nothing? Gosh, I didn't think this one would take this long. It's like, it's probably this, but it's not. Oh well, I'll get it. I'll get it. Once I find it, I'll be like, oh, duh. What's up, random number generator Suze? Yep, debugging, man. I'm debugging. It was that! Oh my god, it's this pattern. Okay, so it's here. And I think the only place I'm using K tile water is right there. And that's true. Yeah, it's only right here. Okay, so why would this line of code right here, distance is less than or equal to 4, why? So I'm confirming it by commenting this line out here. I can't load one or more of the projects. Oh, I don't know what to tell you, man. What's up, Teak? Oh, what? What? I got rid of the water, or no, I just returned from this. What? This is a very curious bug. Cause this function shouldn't be calling anything else. And when I returned out of this function, it didn't do. Wait, is it this closed sides thing? What's the bug? There's some water on this screen. Let me show you. So here's the screen I'm working on. And there's supposed to be water in the middle. Yeah, that's good. Right here, this water, this is great. But there's not supposed to be water down in this lower left corner. It's very weird. I think. Okay, what if I comment out this code? Just dividing and conquering here. Divide and conquer. I'm like commenting out bits of code until I figure out this is so curious. I'm like, what? Why? So I'm just dividing and conquering to find which bit of code it is. ~72,000 lines of code so far. Yeah, great. Okay, so it's somewhere in this for each tile call. Hey, whoa, wait, it might be this block set tile. Tiles. Oh, that's it? It could be this, because mooring is water, but it's like. Oh, this is it. This has got to be it. Yeah, it's right here. Restart, that might help? I don't know. Visual Studio is sometimes like that. There we go. Okay, so it did put them around here. I think that's from the close sides function. Let's check that. Yeah, close sides tile. It's got to be using that for that. So what's D? D's south? When do I think the game's going to be released? I do not know. It's definitely not going to be soon. I'll tell you that. There's still a lot of work left to do. It seems like the game's close to being finished. Yes, I know. From an outside perspective, it's probably like, oh my gosh, it's almost finished. And it really relatively is almost finished. But there's a saying in the game development business that the last 20% takes just as long as the first 80%. Sometimes that's the last 10% takes as long as the first 90%. And it's so true. Polishing a game, fixing all your bugs, finishing all the last little bits of minor content can take a long, long time. And that's what's going on. So I'm working as fast as I can to get the game finished, but I don't have a release date for you. When I do have a release date, you will know. Trust me. I will be blazing it everywhere. I'll be putting it up everywhere I possibly can. I'll be sticking things. I'll be like, boom, boom, put it everywhere. The game's going to be released then. The game's going to be released right then. Trust me. Thank you, man. Thank you. Okay, so we got block set tile here and this one too. And it's okay. So this is actually the way this pattern is actually designed. It's meant to put a bunch of mooring tiles there, but it's just putting them in either the wrong place or something. So I'm gonna go ahead and undo all my changes so far. Wait, not those. This is kind of going too far. Oh yeah, there we go. I think that should put me back to no change. Good, okay, we're back to no change. Now, pattern mooring gate. We know what the problem is. It thinks that it's supposed to block off the bottom, right? This whole pattern here, the point of it is to block off part of the screen so that you have to hit the switch thing to get past that part. So, but I don't think it should ever block the south path unless that really is the way the maze goes. Like, is this actually... No, this is not actually the way the maze goes. Can't be. Or is it? So I could be coming at it... Yeah, I could totally be coming at it from this way. Right? Yeah, I could have come from down here. Could have come from here. Yeah, and this would have got me in here from this bottom section. So totally, I could have come this way, through here, Wait. This is blocked off. Oh, wait. No, I couldn't actually come through this way. How did I in the game when I played the Hold on. Okay, I could come this way. And then here. And then here. And then here. Yeah, this must have been the way I came when I played it that one time. And then here, and then you're stuck. Okay, so the question is, why does the game think that it's supposed to block off the south path right here? When it, well, it could be doing it either way. Cause you could have come from down here, and then here, and then here. And I think this is how I got around it one time. But then I got trolled because, like, it's just a loop. Okay, so it looks like the maze could go either way. Yeah, I know I could give it an access pass from the left, but I'm wondering what is the proper way to handle this situation, because this is a procedurally generated game. There's a lot of different patterns and things like that, the arrangements of all these tiles. So what is the proper way for this to actually happen so that this pattern, when it's applied to different worlds and different situations with lots of different left or right or up or south, down, north, whatever, it works no matter what. So here's where it's going through each direction, each compass direction, north, south, east, west. It's getting the door. Wow, this actually is the proper way for it to do it, because it's just doing this off of the gate, basically. So yeah, south is actually the right way. So maybe there really wasn't a bug here. But no. Oh, I see what the problem is. Okay. So the way this is supposed to work, let's say this were actually in the north, right? Let's say this water right here that's blocking your path. Let's say this was actually up here in the north. That would be okay too. But the problem is this whole pattern is meant to be meant to work for a centered pathway. In this particular instance of this pattern, there's a pathway here on the left side. It's not centered. So you come into this pattern, and what should happen is you should be able to throw your top hat at right and just barely hit that top hat switch thing. So the way I'm gonna solve this is to make it right. So the way it should be is that this switch thing in the middle here, right here, this should be lined up with the pathway that you're trying, that it's trying to block off. Okay, so this is totally doable. So I need to have this all centered based on a center point. So okay, so we need a variable that is basically the center. Before that was W2 H2 minus 1. We need to capture center here. And then this last bit, we use the same variable to define the position of the switch. And we might need to modify this X max, X min, Y min, Y max, and all that accordingly as well. No, I think this is pretty broad. I don't think this needs to be modified. Okay, so let me make sure that still it's in the center. And then I'll try moving it around. I'll set the point to be a little bit different so we can see if that works. Okay, good. Still in the center? Let's try moving it over to the left. All right, this is kind of messing with the rest of the pattern a little bit, but we can fix that later. So if I'm down here now and I come in this way, I can still, yeah, I can hit it. Cool, that works. And then yeah, this pattern would still work. Awesome, now I just need to be able to make it so it's smart, like how to make it so it recognizes that it's a south direction and it's off center, and then it places the center of the mooring and all that. Ahoy, what's up, salad dongs? Right, K-pattern bell secret, there's nothing. This actually works though. This is intentional. There's just nothing there, but it actually, there is something there. There's an item inside there. Okay, I'll start with the next bit, which is to put it off center intentionally. So, I know that each area has, it's not exit points, there it is. So the exit points are known, and each one has a center and a direction. All right, cool, I'm glad it has a direction because now I can match them up really easily. So for each exit point, what's up, Van Zan? Thank you, man. You're watching each video? You're on day 54? You're welcome, man. Thank you for saying thank you. I appreciate that. And I really do hope that each one of these videos, whatever, any of the videos, are helpful, educational, inspiring. You know, I wanted people to see that, wow, this one guy made this game day by day. And if he can do it, I can do it. You know, that's the point that I'm trying to make, the inspiring part. So if that's happening for you, then man, that's great. That's fulfilling my purpose in life. Part of my purpose in life. All right, so I'm looping over each exit point, and I'm checking if it's the direction. So if ep.d, I think it's d. I just had this. I think it's, yeah, there, D, jeez. If EP.D is D, then we want center. Gold mitt, right on. Yay. All right, so if the direction is K dir north or wait, D is a dir, no, so if we want this to be K north or D equals K south, then we want center dot x equals EP dot. Oh, gotta look this up again. I keep forgetting what all this. Oh, EP dot center. Center dot x. Otherwise, we want to take that center y point. And really, I should clamp this so it doesn't get out of control. So clamp by EP center dot x from say W4 to W2 plus W4. So that's going to put it between a quarter of the screen and three quarters of the screen. And then the same thing with the Y here. So this is also going to be H4 and H2 and H4. And then once we do this, we need to break. So we're lining up the mooring switch with the exit point. Let's just make sure that all works. I really should try this pattern out with a lot of different worlds. Man, I thought this would be a lot easier. I was like, I'm gonna put this on my bug list at the top because it's gonna be easy. Bugs are like that. You're like, you never know when one's gonna take an hour and one's gonna take 5 minutes. Yeah, look at that. Okay, so I put the pattern nicely there on the left because it's lining it up here with this exit point. So you can get into the exit and be like, yeah, just barely get it. Move on with your day. All right, I want to make sure though that the water never covers up. Wait, I might want it to actually cover up stuff. I could give it this K tile none, and then it would only cover up some tiles, if they're none, basically. Sure, it sure would, but how complex would it be to make a code like that? It would be very complex. How much would it have to test? And what if your test code had bugs in it, right? It's kind of a thing that would take so long that it's like, you might as well just go with your intuition and go with people testing the game and stuff and leave the glitches in. Sometimes glitches are cool. Oh yeah, so this time it didn't cover up these rocks over here. That's kind of cool. I want it to still have those exit paths and everything the way they are. Oh, except that now you can't get around there. Oh, that's not good. Yeah, and it's setting these ktown on. Okay, so we should keep this out. All right, let's test with this with a few more worlds. Let's go with donkey. And I'll just set a breakpoint here to figure out which of these patterns is mooring gate. Okay, the position is 150. Hey, that's almost exactly what this one was. See, this is a classic example of how it was first designed with a centered path. That's why this is all the way it was. So even though I've already been to that to this north path already, so it already has the mooring tiles and everything. But that's what it's supposed to be like by default. Okay, let's go with another world seed. Let's try a puzzle. This is 350. They all seem to be around the same point. All right, here's another example of it offsetting the path based on the exit point. So this is good. This is a re really good one to test here. So apparently the maze path, you're supposed to come in from the south here. So you would come in from the south, hit the switch. I wonder why the mooring tile though is always down. Guess it really doesn't matter too much. Okay, that one works. Try purple. Boo boo. Boo doo. Boo doo 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 doo. Doo doo doo. 13-4. Hey, we finally have something on the other side of the world. Just trying to find a counter example that would break this. Whoa, this one's weird. I think it's broken. There's no top hat switch. This one's so weird. Okay, well, let's figure this one out, I guess. 13-5, want to take that off. What is killing this tile? Man, just about anything could be. I'm imagining it's add water. Ah, there, good. It was add water. And besides, add water was really kind of messing up this whole pattern anyways. Okay, so this should never happen. If you have pattern, mooring gate, you shouldn't be doing this. I'm glad it was that. That's one of those ones that could have been anything. 72,000 lines of code? Pick one. Could have been any one of those. That's an exaggeration, but still, it's illustrative. Cool, yay, we got a working pattern. I still have not seen an east or a west pattern. Okay, let's try another few world seeds. That was purple. So we'll do please. Please. Visually is a dick sometimes. It is. Why are you getting that error? I don't know what I understand. 13-4 again? The same exact point? These two worlds have exactly the same point for this pattern. Ah, okay, cool. Here's another classic example. Should totally work. Yeah, it's fine. Okay. Once again, let's try another one. Hodor. Fourteen three? It's freaking palindrome. Kinda. I mean, it's the opposite of the last one. Sort of. Not equal to good error messages. Whoa. Whoa. This is one I wasn't expecting. So this must be the edge of a lake. Yeah, it is. This is the corner of a lake. Which is fine, I guess. All right, so how are you supposed to get into this place here? Let's look at the map. Okay, so we are that yellow blinking dot. We could have come in from, oh, so going to the right. You're supposed to come in from the north. Or no, the west. The west, actually. But why is it's gating up to the top because you're going into the next section, is that right? This is the mountains. No, it's supposed to be gating to the right here. Oh, okay, so maybe this is an example of the pattern kind of not actually working out as it's supposed to. Because it should be gating to the right. I guess that would work, yeah, Van Zandt. That's actually a pretty good idea. To go with the combination of each exit for the pattern. Yeah, that's a really good idea. But the thing is, you kind of need the world to be... You kind of need the world to actually to be reflective of that pattern. Because I'm looking at the whole situation here, right? So if I were to just change all the exit points and test all the patterns that way, I would also need it to be like, okay, I need a gate on this side and stuff. So that is a good idea, but it doesn't quite work in this case because of it kind of matters in context of the whole world. So this is 14.3. Let's take away map point 14.4. Oh, you just forgot to extract the folder? Yeah, you gotta unzip the whole zip file. Yeah, Visual Studio does not like trying to run things from a zip file on Windows. Windows is tricky like that, because it doesn't tell you that stuff like that. So I shouldn't be over... You know what? This still works. This pattern still works, but it's not quite gating the right place. We should probably rotate this whole, like, what should happen here is it should be rotating this so it fits on the right. Alright, I mean, all these mooring tiles are over here on the right side. So you would come in, what should happen is you should come in from this side. This stuff should be all walkable. You should be able to, this would just be dirt. You should be able to hit that switch. And then some mooring tiles right here would come up. So, I wonder if this works where... I'm going to check in what I did so far. So far, I fixed two bugs related to this mooring tile. Oh man. All right, so I'm gonna set a breakpoint here. And I wanna see if this is actually using the direction east or west. And then I guess I'll write some code that puts these mooring tiles in the right place. Maybe not. Maybe I'll just go to the next bug. Maybe I'll file another bug about this one, because technically this is a different bug. Okay, direction south, start. This should be east. Oh, it is north. It's counting that as a gate to the north. What is this door? Yeah, it's gating to the north here. Oh. Okay, so this pattern is fine. All right, never mind. I'm done with this bug for now. I don't want to check any more worlds. I don't care if this is broken further than it already is right now. Because I got 96 other bugs I gotta work on. I can come back to this later if I do find that it is a bug. All right, great. So I'm taking this one off the list. This employee is now fixed. Next one. All right, Xanadu 1370 says a secret area blocked by mountains. I go back to my good old trusty world seed, Xanadu 137. Yeah, okay, so here's the problem. This is supposed to be, there's not supposed to be any rocks right here. Right? There's no way I could get over there. You're supposed to be able to walk this secret path over here. So. What is it that's doing that? Is it the pattern quadrant? It might be the pattern quadrant. Divide and conquer strategy. I'm commenting out, I'm basically disabling code to see if it is that code that's causing those mountain blocks right there. I'm gonna get some water real quick. Ah, okay, it was pattern quadrant. So pattern quadrant, it looks like it's actually the southeast and northeast patterns. So is rock a series of functions, a class, or a struct? He's a big jumble of components. Like I was mentioning the other day, Songbringer uses an entity component system. All the objects in the game, like the player, the hero, the enemies, even things like the rock, a single rock in Songbringer is a jumble of components. It's a collection of components. It's called a composition of components, really is the word you would use in programming parlance. You compose versus inherit. It's the way to not be OO. OO would be make a hierarchy of classes, and then basically that's kind of a brittle system. And then using composition, you're using components which are a lot more flexible and a lot more universal and a lot more flexible. Entity component systems are the shit. They're so dope. That's my favorite part about Unity. Even though I don't use Unity because I don't like software for making games, Unity is pretty awesome the way it does work because it's an entity component system. All right, so I want to set a breakpoint here and figure out what kind of quadrants is drawing and then figure out why those quadrants are not allowing. Wait a minute. All the quadrants use this same thing, is open path exterior. Let me see one example. I want to step through some code here. So this is 1370. Man, so I stopped drinking coffee. I got hooked on coffee again. This is like a thing in my life where I start drinking coffee and I'm like, whoa, I love coffee. And then I finally like, dude, coffee makes me a dick. And I stopped drinking coffee and I'm like, wow, I feel so much better without coffee. And I realize how much energy I have without coffee. I'm like a naturally really energetic person. I don't need coffee. It actually makes me slower. I think it makes me faster, but it's not. Life lessons from your good old friend Wizard Foo. Ha! All right. So this door, what kind of door is this? Yeah, it's a door to the east. It's a secret path, though. If this is open path, exterior. Ah, see? It's a secret path, so it's not respecting this is open path exterior to keep a path open towards it. Why would I do that? Why would I ever have this? I guess because I was trying to make it not ever conceal, or not make it obvious that there's a secret path that way, but that doesn't work. Yeah, that doesn't work. I think I might have put this code in here by default because I had that in there before, but this is wrong. Na 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 na, yeah. Yeah, wow, they changed this whole pattern. This whole pattern is totally different now. But you can get in that way. Why would it change the whole pattern though? I don't get that. Did it change the pattern for other stuff? That's what I'm concerned here. If it changed this whole world, I'm like, that shouldn't happen. Okay, so there's this looks like that. This looks like that. This looks like about like that. And that's down here. Okay, let's put that back in. What happened here? What's up, Ultimate Edition? Welcome to the stream and thank you for saying that. Appreciate it. I'm just fixing bugs today. My bug list is like 96 bugs deep. I am doing updates though, like weekly, so. Oh, that really didn't change that much. Okay, I see what happened here. I thought the bottom was different, but the bottom is exactly the same. All it did was it freed up these tiles on the right, and then it just moved the position of this cave right here. So this should be exactly the same. Yeah, it's exactly the same. That's exactly the same. Yeah, everything's fine. Okay, I was freaking out for nothing. Okay, so this is a good fix here. You shouldn't be blocking off those secret paths like that. That was a bad. Whenever I added that little line of code right there, or that sub line of a code, it was a bad move. So what this is gonna be cool, because now when people are playing the game, playing this world or whatever, you'll be able to actually get to this secret. Let's test it out too. It needs to be nighttime. So let's set it to be, I think 400 is nighttime. Yeah, cool. It's nighttime now. There we go. Cool. I don't know what the secret is. get this secret, man. Oh, there it is. Yay, that's it. Diamonds! Okay, cool. Bug fixed! Another one bites the dust! Look how small of a change that is. Fix that bug. Fixed. Secret overworld. Pass from being blocked off by Iron Quadrant. Alright, cool. Yay! It's another one done. Alright, this is something pretty simple here. I want to make it so these some trees don't cover up pathways. Let's go to this example was employ. So we're going back to Mega Seed Employ, World Seed Employ, and it was about like position was about 9-1. Hopefully that's it. Oh, it was not. It was 8-1. Yeah. So here we are. This is the. I was playing this World Seed the other day, and I did not notice that you can get through right here. See, because there's some trees right there. It kind of makes it really unclear that there's a pathway right here. So it would be really nice if the game engine was like, "Hey, I shouldn't put some trees that are gonna totally block off entrances." So I'll save it right here, and. Wait. First of all, before I do that, are these trees on this? Hold on. Yeah, I'll just save here first. I want to see if those trees are actually... if they're on this screen. So if Y... it's less than zero, we'll return real quick. Oh, they are on the screen below. Oh, see, I might have actually already added code for this. Yeah, Zilton's been fixed for a while. Okay. So I removed all the trees. I could take the leaves off the tree. I wonder what it would look like without leaves. If that would work. Or I could make it better about how it places trees. Or changes some trees to bushes. It might be that it's just changing those trees to bushes. Oh, I didn't want it like that. Yeah, you know what? So that just made me realize that this is not going to work. If I just take the leaves off, it wouldn't work for the dark forest. The dark forest has this black fog, which also makes it kind of look like it obscures the path. See, it does look a little clear, but it won't work in all cases. So, okay, undo that. What I really need to do is make sure it's not putting a tree there on the area below, though. So I think it might be this function called bushes to trees. Going to comment this function out. And if this means that there's no trees there, then that means it is this function that's converting some bushes to trees. And then I just need to make sure this function is smart enough to realize that if there's a pathway in the area above, not to convert it the tile to a tree. Yep, that was it. All right, so it was definitely is making everything bushes, and then later on it converts some bushes to trees. I think there's some code here, right? Let's see, stairs position. So it never converts something if it's near stairs. Should be commented. Thank you, Van Zan. Appreciate it. Thanks a lot. Cheers, man. Have a good one. Might as well be kind of updated. I have this macro which is really nice and handy called for each XY. Makes things a little shorter, neater. What the hell? What? These two lines of code, one of them mutually excludes the other, or just excludes. Yeah, okay, I don't definitely do not need this code here. Get rid of that. Well, you know what? I know it seems ridiculous, but I'm just gonna comment it out for now because maybe I'll realize that that was necessary somehow. Yeah, here we go. Okay, so this is the bit right here. Not if the tiles above are not bushes. Dude, this is so easy. Basically, I just need to make sure it's not clamping it by the area's height. Do I use threads? No, I do not. Songbringer uses entirely one thread. That's not totally technically true, though, because Coco's 2DX, the game engine I use, does use multiple threads. But no, my game does not use any multiple threading. I don't believe that's necessary for games. You know, some people can definitely argue. We can argue that all day, right? But I've written so many games and have never had to use that. And I've written multiplayer servers without using multi-threading. I've written single-threaded game servers, which is like the one thing people say you shouldn't do. But I disagree, because I've done it before and it was fine. I think multi-threading can sometimes really complicate your code, especially when you have to use mutexes and simplexes and all that other kind of complexity. Yeah, it worked. So basically all I did was I made the code that I had already written work better. So basically it allows it to check an area above. It doesn't need this code either. So there, we have a better bushes to trees function. Salad Dog's backing me up. If you use vSync and OSX, the easiest way is by multi-threading. Oh, you're not backing me up. You're saying if you do use multi-threading. Yeah. Yeah, vSync does do that, huh? Right? Like vSync can be used as a what was that? I read this one article that we talked about that one time. I don't know. Yeah, Coco's 2DX does use that. Kira Lore, thanks, man. I hope it's interesting. Oh, you're just adding the point? Oh, okay. I don't know. I guess my point is that when code gets complex, it can really slow down your game development, right? So what do you want? You want to make a game or do you want to make a perfect game? Right? And really, does making your game multi-threaded actually make it more perfect? I would challenge that whole statement. Okay, so what this code does is basically just converts. Yeah. Only convert bushes to trees if there are only bushes above, including bushes in the next area. Fixes non-obvious paths hidden by trees. Okay, so that should be really good for when you're exploring the world and you wouldn't have noticed this pathway there. Cool. Okay, so I always thought we kind of thought the same there about those kinds of things, like single threading. Certain cases, multi-threading can be useful, but you really need to make sure you're aware of the trade-offs. Yeah, right. Yeah, totally. Of course, there's always a use for something. For example, if I'm going to write a software renderer. Right. Renderers. That's why I was saying that Coco's 2DX does use multiple threads, and that's the way it does it work. It uses it in its renderer. It queues up all its commands in one thread, and then the renderer thread goes and renders everything. Uh-huh. Multiple cores. Yeah. One more bug off the list. All right. What's up, professional novice? What's up? What's good? Everything's good. I'm working on some bugs here today. I'm going to get on to this next bug here where you get stuck into a room fighting the lightning boss. I did this in World Employee. I think I'm already in World Employee. Yeah. Okay, let's go to World Employee and find this lightning boss room where you get stuck. Right, that is the advantage of single-threaded, right? You have explicit control over when things happen. You have explicit control over your game loop. In a multi-threaded situation, you don't. Sometimes you don't really know when your code's gonna run or when your code's gonna be interrupted. Yes, debugging, the most challenging part of software engineering? Agreed. Okay, I think this might be the room. Okay, so if I hurt her, kill her. I think I'm stuck in this room. Yeah, this is the room. Sweet, found it. Okay, so the bug is I get stuck in this room after beating this little boss here. Basically, what's happening is I'm getting locked in this room, and I should just never get locked in this room. I think this might be a really quick fix. Yeah, that's one of the reasons why the last 20 or 10% of a game takes almost as long as the first 80 or 90% is that you're debugging. You're debugging things. You're fixing things, you're polishing, and that polish takes so long. The debugging takes forever, way longer than the creative time you spend in the game. You can go create things in a game really fast, but then to make them work right, that takes a lot of time. Sometimes bugs are just hella hard to catch. Sometimes bugs take way longer than you thought they would. Okay, I think this lady's called the Lightning Boss Easy. There it is, ship three. I want to do a set flags. Not locked. I think that's how you do set flags. Set flags. Yeah, you do the squiggly. Cool, I think this might have fixed it already. Hopefully, let's see. Eventually adding multi-threaded work queue, your engine, asynchronous asset loading. That would be sweet. Right, but most of your game is still going to be single-threaded, yeah. Oh, right? Seeing the importance of showing your work to trace errors. It was teaching you debugging. It was. It's like Engineering 101. Okay, I think she's gone now. Yeah, she's gone. And yes, I could still open these doors. So it's never gonna lock you in a room. Oh, that's such a weird bug, but it is on my list already. You can like run back through a door before it closes, but only if you're on Songbringer. Oh, she just comes back? That's right, because she never dies. Yeah, okay, so you can always run through, you can run through these kind of rooms. That's fine. That's good. Okay, bug is fixed. Yes, see? That's one of those bugs that took like less than 5 minutes. I love these kind of bugs. This is my favorite kind of bug. One line fix, it takes you less than 5 minutes. Yay! Can't get locked into a room with Lightning Boss. Easy. Another one bites the dust. All right, so, oh, this is something that's gonna take a minute. I want to go find some easier ones. Actually, I do have an idea how this could be fixed. Let me try this idea really quick. Okay, so we're gonna go to back to World Xanadu. And then into the this one. Easy peasy. Here's Steve Tranby's Barrel of Lutefisk. This is a rare collectible item. It's thanks to Steve Tranby for backing the project to such an awesome level. He got to design his own NPC and his own rare collectible item. So that's his rare collectible item. It will actually have a use in the game. It's a lot easier if you're fixing your own code. True, yeah. Oh my God, right? Yeah. Collaborative projects? It's really hard to debug other people's code. It is true if they write bad code, right? If they write good, but it's still hard if they write good code. You know, because you don't, sometimes you don't really know how it worked. So the problem with this is that if you hit, wait, first let's go out. I want to be at, wait, I need to find this point. Barrel of Lutefisk, yeah. And then the other Kickstarter reward was, I did something last night, was a crazy, he wanted a T-Rex with the top hat, and his reward, or his rare collectible item was an amber mosquito fossil. You probably saw it on Twitter. Does it make you more productive to have a Trello board? Well, for me, yeah. Wait, what was that? I forgot to note that point. For me, it does, because I can get things off my mind when people mention a bug, or I find a bug, or whatever. Whenever a bug is found, I can go on my Trello board and post it there, and then forget about it for then. You know, because I'm rarely ever in the state where I can actually go fix a bug when I find a bug. So for me, having a Trello board is really, really handy because it gets things off my mind, allows me to focus on the task at hand, and then come to the, when I have time to go fix bugs, I can come back and just rip through them as fast as I can, solve as many bugs as I can as quickly as possible, and then, you know. So yes, it does make my life a lot more productive. And I used to use a simple text file with just a list of bugs, and that was a lot less productive because I would forget where things were. They would get out of order really easily, and it wasn't as visually easy to see which bugs were what. And most importantly, people can't share it. You guys can't see what bugs I'm working on, or you can't contribute to the list, you know? So this is great because this is a public board. So yeah, I guess it depends on your work situation, but for me, yes, Trello board definitely is very productivity enhancing. So I want to be at 110. And let me show you what the problem is here. If I hit a bush before I want to set it on fire, I won't be able to set it on fire. So here's the thing. There's about the bush that I wanted to hit, and now I'm gonna go try and set it on fire, and nothing happens because I've already hit it. It's lost its hit points, actually, what's going on. It has 0 hit points now. So I have this idea, maybe I can try giving it rechargeable hit points, but I don't think this is gonna work because I think it will take away its activate 0 HP flag. Coco's been, yeah, I told you it would take forever, but at least you're building it now. You fixed the one problem. Man, you're on your path to being a game developer. It's all about fixing little bugs like that. You're like, whoops, I had to extract the zip file first before, you know, little things like that. You learn your lessons, and then it gets easier and easier and easier. Game development just gets easier every day. Well, sort of. But in general, I think you trend towards things being quicker and easier. The bush entity. See, the way this thing works is it has this flag called activate 0 HP. But I think it will lose this flag the second it hits 0 HP. So I could give it a recharge. But not an instant recharge. But actually, recharge duration, there it is. So maybe if it recharges after 1 second, this is my first idea. I don't think this is gonna work. It gets easier, then a lot harder, and then easier again. Yeah, I would definitely agree with that. How do you not get bored with the project or burn yourself out? Both of those are different questions. But I'll start with bored. I think you should write the game that is the most exciting game you can possibly think of, and then you just won't get bored. This is my dream game. Songbringer is my total dream game. I've never gotten bored making it. But now, I guess that's not entirely true. I got bored once. Yeah, you know what? When you do get bored, just go do stuff to refresh yourself. Like, I go to Burning Man, that's amazingly refreshing. Or I go climb some mountains or go hiking, so refreshing. So you gotta learn how to keep yourself refreshed. And I guess that does kind of work with burning yourself out too. If you're burnt out, you also gotta go get yourself refreshed. So that's just the thing, you gotta learn how to keep yourself fresh. And I guess it's different for everybody, right? Yeah, Saladongs, take breaks. I guess some of it is sheer determination. And one way to do that is if you scope your projects really, really small. So when you start out making games, make the smallest, shortest, quickest games you can possibly make, so that you don't have to have that much determination to succeed. Yeah, see, this isn't working because it already activated 0 HP. But if I give it the instant recharge, I wonder if this will work. If I can jostle bushes still, but then... Yeah, that didn't work either. Okay, this particular bug is gonna require some... Oh, whoops, no. Hold on. Take that back. Let's try this the right way before I make the call. You come up with an idea and you spend every free minute for the next 3 weeks and then you get bored. Well, maybe you're just at the point in life where you just need to make 3 week games maximum. In fact, you should probably make games that you think you can make in about a day. And then you can spend 3 weeks finishing that game you started that one day. And then you're done. Check it out. You should check this out, Rocket Bunny. Here's a link you should check out that will really maybe help you out with that. There's a dude that's making he's making 100 games or something. Yeah, 100 games in 5 years. I'll post this link here. But this guy's goal is to make 100 different video games in the next 5 years, and he's kicking ass. He's doing it. So the way he does it is he makes really short games. Just like you could too. You might have made that mistake. You went from competition of a one-page, one-function app to a corporate-sized BLE hardware and software app. Yeah. That's kind of a thing, right? It's hard to stay focused. It's a difficult thing to be determined and to stick through things and to finish things. So that's my advice. If you're one of those people where it's hard for you to stay on a project for long, just do short projects. And if you do get to the point in your life where you do want to finish some great long project, maybe you can take like some significant breaks, like, you know, work on your project for 3 weeks and then take a break for 3 weeks and work on nothing maybe or something else, and then come back to your project, work on it for another 3 weeks. I don't know. It's a very personal thing. You're gonna have to figure that out for yourself. All right, I think it's gonna be the last bug I work on today. For today's stream, I mean. All right, so if I hit this bush... Oh, it worked! Wait, does that mean that I can keep hitting bushes over and over and over, though? It does! Wait, no. Oh yeah, it does! I can keep jostling bushes, that's cool. But what about bushes that have items in them? Oh, I don't think I'm getting any jostling going on here. Or any push. None of these are like dropping anything. Okay, so this might have fixed the problem, but caused another problem. Oh, there was one item right there. That's it? There's only one item on the screen? What about it? Are you seeing a problem with the rain? Or is it nice? I tried to make it 3D recently, and it's so far, I think it's a lot better than it was. Oh, it worked! Oh my god, I think this might have actually solved the problem. Oh, that was weird. The item was on top of him. Oh my god, this might have worked! It's nice, right on. How many lions? I was just checking that today. I think it's about 72,000. Which is great because I haven't really increased that much in the last like 3 months. The last 3 months, it's gone from around 69,000 lions to only 72. That's really good. So that means I'm doing a good job of keeping it, of getting rid of as much code as I'm writing almost. So, yeah, it's getting better. It's getting better because I'm finally writing, because I started making the game data-driven a while ago, right? So there's so much data that controls the game versus writing new code. So had I started the game off with data-driven paradigm, like philosophy, I think I would be a lot farther along this. I would have less code, that's for sure. But I'll probably finish Songbringer with it around 75,000 lines. Because I'm sure there's going to be some new code to write. Will there be any like ancient villages or something? There's going to be, not villages, but there's going to be a lot of old stuff from the war previous. So yeah, there'll be some of that. And some characters. A lot more NPCs. That's all the minor content I'm working on. I'm done. I gotta get some dinner and I'm all tired and stuff now. I'm out of steam. But I think this bug is now fixed too. So I added an instant recharge flag which allowed the bushes to be jostled more than once. And if I test this out some more and it still works, I'll add this to the bushes tiny and also to the trees. So they can just be jostled over and over and over again, but that if they have an item, it should only emit the item once, and this should fix the bug. So that's a lot of bugs. I think I fixed around five bugs, 10 bugs. I don't know. I forget what this number was before. But anyways, thanks for watching, everybody. I appreciate y'all, and I'll see y'all next time.